Good day. First of all, thanks to the organizers for the invitation. I'm Anna Barbaro, PhD in Forensic Genetics and President of the Worldwide Association of Women Forensic Experts. I'm going to talk about forensic science in Italy. As you know, forensic science is the application of science to the resolution of legal issues. This according to the definition of the American Academy of Forensic Science. Forensic science has a long tradition in Italy. The first dissection was performed in the ancient Greece by Acmeon of Croton, now a city in my region, Calabria, in the south of Italy. He discovered the optical nerve, even if he could not understand how it worked. After, in 44 before Christ, in the ancient Rome, Antiochus examined the body of Julius Caesar. In 94 after Christ, the Roman jurist Quintilian analyzed the features of a bloody print to solve a murder case. In the 16th century, two Italians, Fortunato Fidelis and Paolo Zacchia, contributed to the development of the modern pathology by studying the changes in the human bodies after infection. Between 1621 and 1651, they published the Manual of Forensic Medicine in 9 volumes. In 1686, Marcello Malpighi, a biologist and physician at the University of Bologna, discovered the characteristics of the fingerprints. He is referred to as the founder of microscopic anatomy, histology, and the father of physiology and embryology. Giovanni Battista Morgagni, professor of anatomy at the University of Padua, in 1761 published the book De Seribus et Causis Morborum per Anatomen Investigatis, in which he reported all the dissections made through his car on several patients of the Padua Hospital. He dissected the bodies to see if symptoms and disease corresponded to anatomical scenes in the body. Because of this, he is considered the father of pathological anatomy. In 1876, Cesare Lombroso, a criminologist and physician at the University of Pavia and Turin, published The Uomo Delinquente. He founded the Italian School of Positivist Criminology and is referred as the father of criminology. Leone Lattes from the Institute of Forensic Medicine in Turin developed a method of blood testing that determines the type and characteristics of a dried blood stain. And in 1915, he solved a paternity case analyzing blood groups. Forensic science includes criminalistics and criminology. Criminology is the study of crime and deviant behavior. Criminology is an interdisciplinary field in both the behavioral and social science. As we have seen before, the Italian Cesare Lombroso is considered the father of criminology. On the other side, the criminalistics consists in the application of scientific methods to the collection, identification, and comparison of evidence found at crime scene. It uses the contribution of biology, chemistry, medicine, engineering, physics. The Austrian jurist Hans Krauss is considered the father of the criminalistics. Because of this, criminalistics include several fields, as we can see, forensic archaeology, anthropology, ballistic, biology and genetics, botany, entomology, digital forensics, microscopy, forensic geology, graphology, legal medicine, print examination, forensic toxicology. And in fact, all my experience is due to my activity in a private criminalistic laboratory named CIMEF, placed in the south of Italy. This laboratory works under request of the public prosecutor or of the judge and several departments, as we can see here in this slide. And it includes, obviously, a unit for crime scene investigation. This is because forensic science starts at the crime scene. The weakest point in the judicial process is the handling of the crime scene. In fact, according to Locard principle, every contact leaves a trace. There is a relationship between all the elements at the scene, the victim, the evidence, and obviously the aggressor. Because of this, crime scene contains information that must be searched in a systematic, legal, scientific way in order to collect the evidence that can be used as proof to reconstruct the dynamic of the criminal event. In fact, investigation aim is to answer to some questions. What happened? Where the crime happened? Who was the aggressor? Which arm was used? To whom the crime was done? There are some fundamental rules that must be followed during the investigation of a crime scene in order to avoid scene and evidence alteration. They may be resumed in three words: observation, registration, preservation. Main steps include scene securing and documentation, general description of the place, description of each element of the scene, measurement, scene searching, evidence collection, packaging and labeling, adequate evidence storing, and the chain of custody. An incomplete inspection in most cases affects the result of a process. If within the first 24-48 hours insufficient evidence is collected, the case solution can be compromised. In fact, according to Locard, the time that passes is the truth that flies. At all steps, it's necessary to ensure the chain of custody. The chain of custody consists of all the documentation that accompanies the evidence from the crime scene to the laboratory. It serves to demonstrate where the evidence was collected, who collected it, handled it, brought it, when, how, and where. Because of its complexity, CSI must be performed by qualified and trained personnel, following the international protocols that have been developed for the right crime scene evidence collection. Only if adequately collected and preserved, the evidence may be useful for further analysis. An incorrect CSI may compromise all the further investigation. In Italy, forensic investigations may be performed by experts from police forces, this means police and carabinieri, or from university or private institutions. For technical advice during civil trials, a register of experts is available in each civil tribunal, while a different register of experts is available in penal tribunals. I'm registered in both registers of Reggio Calabria Tribunal. Registers are stored by the president of the tribunal, and all decisions relating to the admission to the registers or cancellation are taken by a committee chaired by the president. The committee periodically reviews records to verify if experts still accomplish with requirement. In civil trial, the judge chooses directly a consultant among those registered in the register of the civil tribunal, while in the penal trial, the prosecutor or the penal judge chooses directly a consultant among those registered in the register of the penal tribunal, and according, obviously, to the skills required for the analysis. On the contrary, the defense may appoint anyone as expert. It's not required any registration in any register. According to Italian legislation, defense experts are allowed to participate in all phases of the investigation, either at the crime scene and then at the laboratory. And now let's go to see briefly some cases occurred some years ago in south of Italy. In this case, a man was found dead in the garden of his house, killed with a knife. An investigation was performed inside and outside the house. Apparently, inside the house, everything was in order. But using luminol, it was discovered the presence of some latent blood stains. DNA analysis showed DNA profile of these blood stains was the same than the one of the victim. This indicated the aggression started inside the house and then the flat was cleaned. In this other case, a carbonized body was found inside the car. DNA comparison with the alleged sons and daughter was requested to identify the victim. In particular, we compared the DNA profile of the victim with the profiles of two from the five alleged children. Analysis had a surprising result. The comparison was negative. The body DNA profile was not compatible with DNA profiles of the alleged children. That was really strange because there were many other elements that indicated that the victim was the person who was supposed to be. Due to this, DNA from the other three alleged children was analyzed and DNA profiles compared. In this case, a compatibility was found. This means the victim was not effectively the biological father of all children. This case is interesting for ethical issues because unexpected elements have been discovered during an investigation of a murder case. In this other case, during Christmas holidays, a man was found dead at home with some injuries. His family told the death was caused by an accidental shot from a rifle the son was cleaning, but autopsy showed the man received two shots. During the crime scene investigations, were found blood stains over the walls, the roof, the floor. BPI, blood stain pattern analysis, allowed to reconstruct the dynamic of the event, confirming autopsy's trajectories and verifying the shots were intentional. In this other case, a man was killed when he was playing a billiard in a bar. Here we can see the crime scene photos. At the crime scene were found on the floor some blood drops, a bloody shoe print, and a glove fragment. A witness referred that it was belonging to one of the rescuers who tried to save the boy. Anyway, since each element at the crime scene may be important and cannot be left out, we decided to collect also this glove. Laboratory analysis showed onto the glove the presence of some blood stains, which DNA profile was belonging to a man different from the victim. In addition, there was some grip powder onto the glove. Electronic microscopy analysis confirmed it was a gunshot residue, as we can see in this slide. This means the glove had been dressed by the killer who probably injured himself while using the gun. After some weeks, during the inspection of a suspect house, inside the wardrobe, it was found a pair of sports shoes. The comparison between the shoe sole and the bloody shoe print showed a perfect overlap. The suspect was arrested, and then DNA analysis confirmed his DNA was the same of the blood stains onto the glove. This case, in my opinion, is an example of the relevance of a correct evidence collection at the crime scene. If an evidence is not collected, the entire investigation can be compromised. In the last years, television shows, movies, and true crimes produced expectations for the contribution that the sciences and technologies can offer, not only in solving violent crimes, but also cyber crimes, chemical attacks, mass disasters. This so-called CSI effect has resulted worldwide in an increasing and sometimes excessive interest by students, professionals, common people towards forensic science. In fact, many persons started their careers in the field due to media influence. But reality is really different from what appears on TV. And real problems and difficulties are great. In fact, due to the hard confrontation with reality, it happens that many people who started forensic activity with great expectations then are not able to go on. Because of the complexity of forensic science, and since results of forensic analysis may contribute to establishing the guilt or innocence of a person, this field requires a great scientific competency that may be only achieved by specific education and training, pluriannual experience, application of standardized scientific protocols, participation in proficiency testing, and obviously stringent professional ethics. Therefore, it's necessary to attend courses on specific topic of interest, because a good expert must have a specific and not only general knowledge of everything. In addition, in some countries, such as United States, the quality certification of forensic expert is required to demonstrate their effective competence to carry out the activity in a specific area and to discuss results at the court. You can find all this information in the Manual of Forensic Science I published in 2017 USA by CRC Press. The manual is the result of an international collaboration between experts in different forensic areas, most of them from the Worldwide Association of Women Forensic Experts Network. Another manual has been published last year in Spain, and now a new one about the CSI is in publication USA, always by CRC Press. Thank you very much for your attention. Feel free, please, to contact me by email or social networks. Thank you again to the organizer for the invitation. Sincerely hope you enjoyed my presentation. Thank you.